BookTube, Sarah here, and welcome to my channel. Today I'm coming to you with my weekly reviews for September the 29th through the 5th of October. So we are going September into October. The first two books I'm going to talk about I finished at the tail end of September, and then the other three are from October. So five books in total for this week. So let's jump in and get started. The first book that I finished was Christmas from the Heart by Sheila Roberts. This was a contemporary romance novel. I did listen to it on audio. It was narrated by Terry Schulbolt, excuse me, published, of course, in 2019. This came out actually on September the 24th. Average rating on Goodreads was 4 stars. I gave this one 3 stars. For my challenges, this was a triple RC, and it was for World Gratitude Day, and it was a book that you were grateful for. And special thanks to NetGalley and Harlequin for providing me with an e-art copy of this one to read, even though I did listen to it on audio. So this was a very much a Hallmark movie type book. I can absolutely see this book becoming a Hallmark movie. My biggest problem, and the reason this one only got 3 stars as opposed to like a 3.5 star rating, was because I really didn't care for our main character, Olivia. So the premise of this story is about a woman by the name of Olivia who lives in a small town, and she runs a nonprofit organization that called Christmas from the Heart, that does, like, you know, they work all year long to get donations, but then at the Christmas season they give to less needy people. They are, or needy people, not less needy, but needy people, families and single parents and stuff like that. They do everything from stockings to food to toys for kids to monetary donations to families. Like, it sounds like a really great organization. So it was started by her grandmother, and then it was passed to her mother, and her mother passed a number of years earlier, and now Olivia is running the organization. So there is one company, a large company called Hightower Enterprises, that donates, like, is their big contributor. They are their big donation every year, and they rely on it every year for the bulk of their donations that come in. And this year it starts off in May, and she's, like, you know, emailing the people at the company, and unfortunately they cannot donate what they used to. There were cutbacks within the company themselves. Now, she's not privy to any of this. It's kind of more of a, you don't really need to know this. It's more, unfortunately, I'm sorry, we are unable to help you. You know, they did give a little, but not to what they used to give. The money that they had set aside for charity work was more towards larger name, bigger name organizations. And she's a very small local organization. You do find out later in the story exactly why. The grandmother used to get these donations from this huge company. So anyway, Olivia, I begin to dislike her very much because she pretty much hounds this company. She doesn't care what they're going through. She doesn't care. In her eyes, they are a large organization. They should definitely have this money. I don't care what you say, blah, blah, blah. You should definitely have this money. And I mean, sending very rude emails to this gentleman by the name of Guy. Hightower is our male lead in this book. So he ends up cutting through this small town on his way to his mom's place for dinner a few days before Christmas. And of course his car breaks down and he is picked up by Olivia, but he lies to her and doesn't tell her who he is. He finds out right away who she is when she gives her name, and he realizes that this is the woman. So of course he kind of starts falling for her, but it's a whole ruse because he's not telling her who he is. And again, you know, that part of it, it's standard for a contemporary romance story. It's a standard kind of plot line. But Olivia just really bothered me. I understand that this charity was extremely important to her and important to the people that it helps. I totally get that. But even if they are a large company, you have no idea what's going on behind closed doors. You have no idea, you know, if that company is in the black or not. You have no idea if they've had to let off, you know, let go of employees because they can't meet the bottom line, kind of an idea. And I just found her to be extremely pushy, and it wasn't really the Christmas spirit. Do you know what I mean? She would go through town, and she was like harassing people for donations. And I get it. Again, you know, I see it's a very worthy cause, and I understand that. But everybody, you know, is strapped for cash, and not everybody can give everything. Do you know what I mean? So yeah, I really didn't like her, and that was my main reason for not enjoying the book. I mean, the story itself was great. I enjoyed it, but I just, like I said, I just didn't care for her. The next book that I finished was Autumn Alibi by Jennifer David Hess. This is a cozy mystery novel. It is book number 6 in a Wiccan Wheel mystery series. This was also published in 2019. It also came out on September 24th, and I did read this one as an e-arc. The Goodreads average rating for this book was 4.47 stars, guys. I gave it 4.5 stars. I really enjoyed this book. For my challenges, this was for number 6, which was Friday the 13th, which was to read a spooky mystery type book. So what I loved about this story was that, in a way, it was the perfect blend between like Nancy Drew and Agatha Christie with a witch as the spin on it. So the premise of this story, our main character, Kelly, this is the 6th book now. So she has fallen into these kind of mysteries before, and she works as a lawyer. She has a private practice. She used to work for a more corporate law firm. And one of the gentlemen that she used to work with has called upon her help because there's this estate now that the matriarch of the family essentially passed away. Her husband passed years earlier. She had one son, and he passed away a number of years ago. And she had one granddaughter, and that granddaughter ran away from home when she was 17, many years earlier. So essentially, this former coworker of Kelly's is being tasked with figuring out what's going on with the estate and with the will. The granddaughter was left a sole beneficiary in the will, but she has, of course, gone missing. So, and she hasn't been heard of in like 13 years or something like that. So he's kind of tasking Kelly to find the granddaughter, to find where she is. And now there's some people who were working for the woman who passed away, Elaine, and they're saying she drafted another will and they want to find this other will. So, like I said, it was very much, you know, like there wasn't necessarily a murder that took place. Supposedly this woman died of natural causes, but it's more that whole, you know, finding a missing person, finding a missing will. And that's why I say it was like, it just, I had this grown-up Nancy Drew vibe from it, because those were the kind of stories and plot lines that you got from Nancy Drew. You know, it wasn't necessarily mayhem and murder that you usually see in cozy mysteries where somebody is killed, you know, and the amateur sleuth stumbles over the dead body. This was very much more a missing will and a missing, heiress and things like that. And it was delightfully fun. It also, I kind of felt like that whole "and then there were none" vibe, even though nobody else was really murdered. But the fact that it was all took place in this massive estate, and you know what I mean? It was just so delightfully fun. I really, really loved it. I highly encourage you guys to read this series, whether or not paganism and witchcraft and Wicca is something that you are into or something that you are interested in. I know for a lot of people it might go against their personal beliefs, and I get that. And there is, you know, a touch of that in there. She does, you know, pray to the goddess. She does. And it's what I love about it is that it's completely natural. It's not made to be a big deal. People in town know what her beliefs are, and they don't question her for it. They don't look down upon her for it. It's just, it'd be no different than if she went to church every Sunday and was Christian. Do you know what I mean? So, you know, if, you know, regardless, I personally am not of the Christian faith, but I really enjoy like the love-inspired books from Harlequin. So, you know, I think on the flip side, if even if you are a Christian, I think you could completely appreciate these books for what they are and maybe learn something about somebody else's personal religious beliefs. You know, it's a real eye-opener that this is more mainstream, that, and that's what I think I really, really love about this series, that it just so happens that this is what she is, and it doesn't change who she is and what she does, and you know, and the friends that she has and the boyfriend that she has and all those things. And it was delightful. I love this series so much. This is the second book I've read in this series, and my goal is to go back and read all of them. There, I believe, will be 2 more, because I believe they follow each of the Sabbats, or follow around the Sabbats. They're not going in order of them. The series is jumping around a little bit. That's absolutely cool. You know, the chances are of a person running into a mystery over the course of an entire year happening exactly 6 weeks from each other are, you know, that's a little extreme. So I do love the fact that the author it's spanning over several years and they are kind of jumping around a bit. And I really do like that. And again, highly recommend this series. The writing in it is great. The characters are great. Kelly is a fantastic main character. I love her boyfriend, Wes. I think he's just a hoot. And her friend, Farah, is just delightful. And all the other secondary characters are just great too. highly recommend the series. I cannot, if you love a good cozy mystery, definitely check this series out. The next book that I finished was Death by Pumpkin Spice by Alex Erickson. This was the first book that I finished for the month of October. This is a cozy mystery series, it's a cozy mystery book. It is book number 3 in the Bookstore Cafe mystery series, and I'm going to get into this in just a second about this series. This was narrated on audio by Melissa Moran, publication date of 2016. Average rating on Goodreads of 3.37 stars. I gave this one 3.5 stars. So, if you guys know, in September, I was trying to follow along with the Cozy Escape Book Club, hosted by Courtney over at The Cortagonist and Lisa Latte Books. And they were reading the first book in the series, Death by Coffee. I couldn't get through it. I got about halfway through it, and then I just found I had absolutely no interest in picking it up. But I did realize when I put together my October TBR that I did have like extra room for audiobooks. I didn't have a lot of audiobooks to read, and I do like having audiobooks to read to and from work and when I'm on lunch and stuff like that. So I knew I could add some more in. So I decided to go ahead and add 4 in, because 4 is a good number. And I picked a couple cozy mysteries. I picked a thriller, and I'm trying to think of what else I picked. I think it was like 3 cozy mysteries and a thriller. One of them is an Agatha Christie, so that's very exciting. But anyway, this is one of the books I happen to add, mainly because this is the first book in the series that drew my eye, Pumpkin Spice. I'm a huge fall lover. I love Halloween. I love all those things. So I had this one on my TBR to read, and I found it through Scribd, on audio. So the audio of it was really, really good. I enjoyed that. The reason this one got 3.5 stars is, and I think the reason that I had a hard time trying to get through that first book was I really didn't like the main character. What's her name? Chrissy. I'm sorry. She was a little too much into other people's business. I get that it's an amateur sleuth story. I get that it's a cozy mystery. And the whole point is that she's supposed to be sticking her nose into other people's business. But in one scene in this book, she is... Okay, so let me go back. Let me jump back. The plot of this story is about Chrissy, and she gets invited to this very hoity-toity Halloween party that's held every year by these very wealthy people who live in this huge mansion. And the husband had recently passed away of this couple who used to host this party. And he was very, very much into Halloween. Like, the whole house is decorated up. Different rooms are like different horror movies and based on, you know, it's really weird and really wacky. And she gets invited to this Halloween party, and she goes with this guy who's a doctor that she's gone out for coffee with them, and there's nothing official between the two of them. She still actually has feelings for one of the police detectives from the first book, I think, that you met in the first book, at least. I haven't read the second book. So they're at this Halloween party, and they find somebody is murdered. And then it becomes, as I mentioned earlier in the Autumn Alibi, it becomes very much and then there were none feeling. Where all these people, all these party guests are trapped inside this house and they're looking for the killer. Nobody else is murdered, but yet the entire story, except for, I think, like the first 15 to 20% where it's like the lead up to her going to this Halloween party, takes place over the course of a single night in this mansion, in this kind of kooky, crazy, very Addams Family-esque mansion where this murder took place. So as I was saying, there's one scene in the book where Chrissy goes into where the murder took place. So she's at the crime scene, and they've covered the body with a cloth, and they've kind of done their best to put, like, you know, they don't have any police tape or anything on there. There's a storm raging outside, so the actual police haven't arrived yet, although Paul, that police officer, is there, blah, blah, blah. And she goes and she's literally picking the sheet up off the body to examine it. You are not a coroner. You are not a CSI. You are not a police officer. I want to find out what happened. Okay, well, good for you. Let the professionals do their job. You know, I can appreciate in a cozy mystery that, you know, these amateur sleuths asking questions about things. But when they cross that line to something that becomes the fact where in a court of law, if it comes up and it says, well, we saw her in the room with the body, what evidence did she disturb? And the actual killer can now get off because of a technicality. Now you're crossing a line, in my opinion. And I just really didn't like her attitude that she had to know everything. She was demanding the police officer that she sit in an interrogation. Really? Like, it was a little much. You know what I mean? And I just think that I just didn't like her. Now, I did listen to this one on audio, and I was able to get through it because on audio, I find it's easier. You're kind of in the car driving and you're kind of there, you know, whereas when I was reading the book, I would just get annoyed and put it down. You know what I mean? So I think I want to go back, and because the mystery itself, the reason it got 3.5 stars is the mystery itself was really good. I didn't know the whodunit. Like, I think I figured it out at about the 70-75% mark. And I think I was like, kind of like, I think this is where we're heading. And it turned out I was right. And that was fine. I mean, you don't, you know, sometimes it's fun regardless. If you figure it out at the beginning or it's a surprise at the end. Either way, the story was still enjoyable. So that's the thing. Like, I liked the story and I liked the mystery. I just didn't like her. So this would have absolutely gotten a 4-star or even a 4.5-star from me if I liked the main character, and I just didn't. But like I said, I do want to go back and read books 1 and 2 and continue on with the series. Like I said, they are available on Scribd, so I'm definitely going to be listening to them on audio. So do keep that in mind. If this is a cozy mystery that you're not too sure about, in my personal opinion, I just think the main character crossed a few too many lines where it comes in terms of technicalities and things like that in a murder investigation. But other than that, the mysteries themselves are absolutely fantastic. The next one that I finished, oh my gosh, you guys, this book was so good. If this book doesn't make my top five for October, I will be surprised to see what books actually do. And that is The First Lady and the Rebel by Susan Higginbotham. This is a historical fiction novel. It was published in 2019. This came out on October 1st, so this was another eARC from NetGalley. Goodreads average rating of 3.93 stars. Guys, I give this one 4.5 stars. Oh my gosh. Whoa, almost dropped my tablet. I love this one. For my challenges, for my RRRC for October, this was for Bird of the Month Swan, which was a book with a really pretty cover, and that cover is just gorgeous in my opinion. So again, special thanks to NetGalley and Sourcebooks for sending me a copy of this to review. Oh, and I'm sorry, I completely forgot to mention it, but thank you to NetGalley and Kensington for the eARC of Autumn Alibi. So The First Lady and the Rebel, oh my gosh. I had no idea I had a great interest in Civil War historical fiction. I had no idea. Gone with the Wind is one of my favorite books of all time. But Gone with the Wind, as much as it's a story of... I still have a hard time classifying Gone with the Wind as a romance, as much as I love romance. There is romantic elements in it. Gone with the Wind is the story of Scarlet, and it's also the story of the Civil War. But it's more so her, because of the time period it was written. And I know a lot of people find it very problematic because of the language that she used and how they kind of whitewash the antebellum South at that time, and I get it. But to me, it's still a classic story, and I absolutely love it. It's in my top 10 of all time. But in September, I read Hanging Mary by this same author, by Susan Higginbotham, excuse me. And that one was also about the Civil War. And it turns out that I read the author's note at the end of this book, and she is, Abraham Lincoln was her favorite president. So there's obvious reasons why she's writing around that, those events in his life. So the First Lady and the Rebel is about, Mary Todd Lincoln, President Lincoln's wife, and her half-sister named Emily. So this jumps back and forth between two different narrations, between Mary and between Emily. And Mary had a very difficult life. Her mother passed when she was young, and I think she had 3 older siblings. And then her father ended up remarrying, and then now she had 4 younger half-siblings from her stepmother and her father. So one of these half-siblings is Emily. And the reason this did not get a 5-star from me is because the very beginning of this book, the first 2 chapters, are super long. And they are a lot of background on how Mary met Abraham Lincoln and how they courted and then how they eventually got married. And then the story starts when he is elected to the first, for his first term as president. And then the war, of course, the Civil War starts very soon after that. And essentially the entire book follows the course of the Civil War. You find out about all the different battles. You find out about, you know, all the different generals. And but it wasn't boring in any way, you guys. I was so compelled to pick up this book every chance I got. I mean, over the course of the days I was reading, it was Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday of this week. Luckily, it was relatively quiet at work for me. So because my book was on my phone, I did a little bit of reading at work. And I was so engaged just to go ahead and pick it up again because it was that engaging and that good. The characterization for both Mary and Emily was great. So the whole thing about the lady and the rebel, the first lady and the rebel, is that, of course, Mary, being married to President Lincoln, is, of course, on the side of the Union and the northern states and things like that. Whereas Emily actually ends up marrying a Confederate general. And the two sisters, of course, are at opposite sides of the Civil War. And that's pretty much the bulk of the story. I mean, other than, you know, there's nothing here that is going to be a surprise, you know. The book pretty much ends with the assassination of President Lincoln, spoiler alert. And, you know, you really realize what a difficult, difficult life that Mary actually had. You know, her youngest child died in infancy. And then one of her boys, she had four boys, another one of her boys who was actually deemed the favorite by both President Lincoln and Mary, Willie passed away while he was serving his first term in the White House. And then her next son passed away after Lincoln was assassinated. So then her husband was assassinated. And then she, you know, then her next son dies. So she's left with her oldest boy, Robert. You know, she lost three of her sons and her husband during her very short life. She only lived to, I think, be 63 or something like that. Now, Emily, she lost her husband in the war. I don't want to say too much more than that because not as much is known about Emily. But she had a few children, and one of her daughters, her oldest daughter, Catherine Helm, I believe is her name. She wrote her aunt's biography. So she wrote a very well-known biography of Mary Todd Lincoln, which I know the author's note said that a lot of people should read, and I might try and hunt it out. So that was written by her niece, which is very, very interesting in my opinion. And the sisters did connect again after the war, but there was still, you know, and then Emily lived to be like 93. Her and Robert were both there. I read all this in the author's note. And the author's note, to be honest with you guys, is one of my favorite things about reading historical fiction. I just love getting the background. So essentially the story ends not long after the assassination of President Lincoln. So anyway, Emily and Robert were both at the centennial of Lincoln's birth when they unveiled a statue in his honor. They were the only two left because Mary had passed many, many years earlier. It does not delve into Mary's life after the assassination and after she left the White House, you know, had to leave the White House, obviously. You know, even though there's been a lot written about that, and that part of her life is very, very interesting as well, and I'd like to read more about that. Her son tried to have her committed, because he thought that she was going a little off the deep end, if you will. She was spending a lot of money. She fought the government for a pension that she very well deserved. You know, all these things, and it was fascinating, you guys. Absolutely fascinating. As a Canadian, you know, the Civil War has always something that's fascinated me. And this really gave me a bit more insight into it that I didn't know before. Because I took American history and literature in school. It was one course. You know, I one semester, I took American history. So that is my bulk of the knowledge of American history, other than what I get from books. And if you are into the Civil War, if you are interested in all in the Lincolns, I highly recommend this book. It was absolutely fantastic. And I think it's a lot of things that you are not necessarily going to know, even if you have read biographies of Mary Todd Lincoln or President Lincoln or anything at all like that. Absolutely fantastic. Highly, highly recommend. I absolutely love this book. And the last book that I finished this week was Jamaica Inn by Daphne de Maurier. This, I'm considering it a classic. I think it's a modern classic. I think you could also go with like a gothic romance or a gothic mystery or something like that. But I just decided to shelve it under classic. This was narrated on audio by Tony Britton. It wasn't bad on audio. It wasn't great. The narrator was a male. But the story itself is narrated, not narrated in first person, but it's third person, from the perspective of a 23-year-old woman. So it was a little odd in the choice of having a male narrator, but it is what it is. And it's the edition that I listened to, because there's several different audio recordings of this one, is an Audible exclusive. And, you know, I did like it, but it wasn't fantastic. Let's put it that way. This was originally published in 1935. Average rating of 3.86 stars on Goodreads. I gave this one 4 stars. For my RRRC for October, this got challenge number 9, which was Halloween, which was to read a spooky, scary book, and this one absolutely fit the bill. So, I can say now, having read this and Rebecca is still my favorite de Maurier, but this one definitely was really, really good too. I was talking to my mom about it, because my mother has read a good chunk of her work, and she read this many, many, many years, probably well before I was born. was the last time that she read this book, but she still remembers it. And I think it's going to be one that's going to stick with me as well. This book was extremely atmospheric. I mean, the setting of the moors was almost like another character, if that makes sense. It was brilliant. So this is the story of Mary, and at the age of 23, she becomes an orphan. Her mother passes away. She had been living at home on the farm. This takes place maybe 100 years before the book was actually written, I think. I'm not exactly sure when the exact time period is, but that's my guesstimate. I could be wrong. Of course, she has no suitors or anything like that, so she has an aunt by the name of Patience, and she met Patience many, many years ago, and Patience was young and carefree, and she had bouncy blonde curls, and she was, you know, very animated, very lively. So when her mother passes away, Mary is then sent to live with this aunt at this place called Jamaica Inn, which is in the moors. And when she shows up, she meets her uncle, who is a very rough and tumble, a very dangerous man. And when she re-meets her aunt for the first time again after so many years of not seeing her, probably close to a decade, she's a completely different woman. She's drawn. She speaks like a child. Her hair is gray. She's timid. They often refer to her as like a little dog following around her husband, like a little puppy dog kind of an idea. He obviously beats her a great deal, sadly. There is a lot in here about abuse and things like that. So again, it's a classic, but be forewarned. And essentially, it's of the goings-on of Jamaica Inn, and I don't want to say anything more than that. I didn't know anything going into this. I had a feeling it had something to do with pirates, because there's a pirate ship on the cover. That's all that I knew. Or a ship of some kind. And obviously something was happening at this inn, in the moors. The ending of this book, I can say, left me rather unsettled. For those of you who have read it, please comment in the description box or in the comment section below. I don't want to give any spoilers away, but let me know if it's the same thing. And I've mentioned that to my mom yesterday, and she says, really? And I said, yeah, but I think that was the point. You know, that's the point of one of her books, is that it's meant to leave you unsettled. And I don't want to say why it left me unsettled, because my mother kind of, I don't know if she really remembered. And I mentioned to her and explained, and she says, oh yes, that makes sense. So if you have read, you know, Jamaica Inn, please let's have a little conversation below, because I want to know if it was just me, like if I'm the only one who gleaned that from the ending of the book. Highly enjoyable. I know Karen from Rather Be Reading just finished one of her books last week, a lesser known de Maurier. And I still want to read Frenchman's Creek, and I still want to read My Cousin Rachel. And I would like to read The Birds as well, which I know she wrote as a short story that became the Alfred Hitchcock movie. I've never seen the movie, but I would very much like to read the book. But my mom couldn't remember if there was a movie made off of this book, off of Jamaica Inn. I know there was one made off Rebecca, and I know there's a more modern retelling movie made of My Cousin Rachel starring Rachel Weisz. So that I'd like to see too. But if anyone knows any more, please let me know. She's very quickly becoming a favorite author of mine, and I would like to read through all of her work. I'm going to have to see how they came out in chronological order, and maybe go back and start at the beginning and work my way through and reread Rebecca again. But yeah, this one I really, really enjoyed. If you have not read Daphne du Maurier, please do yourself a favor. They are fantastically written. Like I said, wonderfully atmospheric, great characterization. And the perfect amount of hair on the back of your neck standing up creep factor to make them great. You know, they're not like a modern day horror story where it's about blood, guts, and gore. This is very, in a way, psychological, you know, where you're seeing things from Mary's perspective, but you don't know everything, right? So yeah. Really, really great novel. Highly enjoyable. So anyway, guys, that is all that I have for this video. I do hope that you enjoyed it. Please let me know in the comments below, have you read any of these books and what did you think about them? Or what was your favorite book that you finished in this last week? I'd love to know that too. And until my next video, everybody, take care and happy reading. Thank you all so much for watching. Bye, guys.